Two or three points regarding what this session is supposed to be addressing. You know, policy dialogue, synthesis, directions, and issues of further research. Now, as regards that, we can divide it in terms of different levels of engagement and comprehension and so on. Now, if you look at, let's say, the progressive scholarship for the last 30, 40 years, which has generated huge amount of research, huge amount of evidence and so on. And as since Marx was quoted just now, let me also quote Lenin, who said that, you know, excellent policy can flow only from excellent theory. And that theory is what then leads you to, you know, next level of not only policy, but what the strategy should be and so on and so forth. So there is huge amount of evidence that has come up as regards the multiple problems, the larger what Craig sort of described as the ecosystem or the environment within which some of these policies are being made, unmade and so on. So at that level, essentially you have two broad views. One is, it is almost impossible to make a substantive progress as long as the neoliberal globalization is firmly in place. So what you need to do is to get out of that neoliberal globalization. That's one point of view based on the, you know, very, very large progressive scholarship and so on. Late Samir Amin, for instance, you know, he started talking about it almost 50 years ago, that, well, late 60s, early 70s, that if you get trapped into it, there is no future. The vulnerability that Paris talked about and so on and so forth. So that's one point of view as regards if a symposium has to come to some understanding in what we should be doing. Then of course the kind of policies, strategies that we're talking about would be very different. Right? So if that is the conclusion which you consider sympathetic and so on. So, Samir Amin, you have, for instance, the entire monthly school research and literature which has been trying to convince us along those lines. Eminent Indian political economist Prabhat Patnaik, who has been talking about it at least for the last 25 years or so, that we are in an era of spontaneous capitalism which gives you certain kinds of outcomes which you just can't control. You may want to control them, you want to sort of regulate and so on and so forth. Let me just give you one number to put things in place. 4 years ago, I looked at, based on the TNI data, which are the 100 most powerful economic entities. And this is 4 years ago. Of the 100 most powerful economic entities, 51 were corporations, 49 were countries. Right? Last year, with a gap of only 3 years, I am revisiting the same question, 69 are corporations, 31 are countries. Right, you're talking about the most powerful economic actors in the world. Right? Imagine, you know, a Walmart negotiating with Cambodia. Right? Sort of 500 plus billion, or Amazon 1 trillion plus billion USD, and a country which is 4 billion, 5 billion, 2.5 billion and so on and so forth. 170 countries currently in the world sort of are below all these humongous powerful actors and so on and so forth. Now, given that, now of these, again, if you look at just another number, top 100 MNEs today, 92 are headquartered in advanced countries. Only 8, of which 4 are in China, right? And others are scattered here, Brazil, here and there, and so on and so forth. So, of the top 100 MNEs, these are the existing realities of the economic, global economic structure that you have to take into account. Right? Other things feed into that. You know, whether it's agriculture, whether it is industry and so on and so forth. Right? So keeping that broader sort of, you know, so that is one point of view. Right? You may sort of take that wholeheartedly with a pinch of salt, with a ladle of salt, or you may reject it. Right? But that is one point of view. And then what would be the policy questions? How do we reclaim the national economic policy space? How do we reclaim things which we could not do, but we wanted to do during the regulated capitalist regimes and so on. Dirigism wanted to do 1, 2, 3, 4. It succeeded in some ways, it failed in many ways. Right? So, can we then go back to that? Yeah? Can we try and sort of push all our energies in terms of thinking about policies, strategies, etc., along those lines? So that's one point of view. Second point of view is, where again you have a large number of progressive scholarship, which says, that seems too difficult. Let's do something here and now, right? In terms of trying to impact the way this neoliberal globalization can be civilized, can be made somewhat better and so on and so forth, right? Huge scholarship there, very well-meaning people and so on. Then you say, all right, if we can have this particular provision, if we can have this particular law, etc., this particular sort of intervention through global arrangements, etc., maybe something can come out of that. Now, unfortunately, the evidence that we can see for the last 20, 25, 30 years is not giving us any confidence as regards the second point of view. Right? I'm not saying you throw that lock, stock and barrel. I'm not saying you reject that entirely. Right? But you also have to look at the evidence which is accumulating and in terms of whether with respect to agriculture and so on. So I wanted to start with these, you know, two very broad kind of considerations, okay, in terms of how do we frame our conversations about policy dialogues, about strategies, about where we are, about where we can be headed and so on. Having flagged these two broad sort of, let's say, approaches, yes, as regards, you know, the kind of exercise which is happening here, can there be some interventions in terms of thinking about contract farming, what kind of policy dialogues are helpful there, etc. Right? I mean, I think FAO has done very good work. Right? I mean, I'm the first one to sort of salute FAO for, let's say, BGGT or CFS RAI and so on and so forth. Yes, it has put in place a number of, but it has no bite. There's no legal backing whatsoever. Even when some of these partially or in some small ways can translate it into national policy making, there is zero respect for that in the country in question. So it's not the case that, you know, it's absence of a legal framework, right? On many aspects, in India we have, Professor Sukhwan Singh was telling you about on contract farming itself, we have an act which in many ways possibly is better than what you have thought through, as he was pointing out, right? But not only that, related to that, you have a number of legal things, but zero respect. And we are talking of laws now. We are not talking of something which is, you know, Mother Teresa kind of whatever, yeah? Meaning, you want to be good-hearted and so on and so forth, and you say, all right, yeah, look, how the world is so terrible and what can be done about it, let's at least think in, yeah? So, in spite of that, if you don't have, so it is challenges of this kind. It is indeed the case that by putting all this on the table, okay, by engaging movements, etc., engaging various kinds of energies and so on, there can be, in principle, at least very valuable conversations. Right? But let us not kind of get into this illusion that beyond meaningful conversations, something else will come out of it. Right? I did a paper for FAO on BGGT about Indian companies. India is one of the so-called signatories there, right? In terms of endorsing it. And Indian state is encouraging complete violation of BGGT as regards the way its companies are functioning in Africa. Right? Just look at them. Each one of them without exception. And state is in complete collusion. Right? What do you do then? So yes, you know, let's have this conversation. Right? It's good to have these conversations. so that many of the issues on that we get better clarity. Now, how our imbalances can hopefully be redressed to some extent, wee bit, right? And I'm all for that, but it's also Antonio Gramsci, you know, pessimism of intellect, optimism of will. That is where I'm stuck as regards all your discourses on contract farming. Pessimism of intellect, I don't see anything there in terms of any worthwhile movement, but these exercises are important, not only because we are in contract with you, as I said earlier, right? The institute and all its studies, etc., you know, but obviously we have to have these conversations. With that, let me stop. Thank you for your attention.